All right.
And with
Hi,
that,
Josh.
Josh, you're gonna finish us.
Yeah. We've got Weezer and their technically self-titled album, but it's known as the Blue Album. And in the opening montage, you heard Buddy Holly, and now you're gonna hear In the Garage. Okay, Matt, where are the stats?
Weezer's Blue Album comes in at number 15 in the 1990s on Best Ever Albums, number 4 in 1994, number 80 of all time. It is Weezer's highest rated album on Best Ever Albums, and it also made Rolling Stone's list, coming in at number 294. And Weezer is ranked number 49 of overall artist rankings on Best Ever Albums.
Nice. Well, the Blue Album came out May 10th, 1994. Weezer formed in LA and on February 14th, 1992, that's the exact date, the band is Rivers Cuomo on vocals and a guitar, Brian Bell on guitar and vocals, Matt Sharp on bass and vocals, and Patrick Wilson on drums. Guitarist Jason Cropper was originally in the band and on the recording of this album until he was fired for being erratic, and Rivers and Matt Sharp did not want to mess with the chemistry of the band when the album was coming out. So later on, Jason Cropper agreed with that decision, but at the time he did not like it.
You have to be pretty erratic to be kicked out of, I mean, Rivers yeah. Cuomo famously like went through a period where he painted his walls all black, right? And he didn't leave for like 6 months.
Yeah.
So that's something else.
Yep. So Brian Bell came in to replace him during the recording. Weezer has 15 studio albums, and this is the first. They are considered alt rock, power pop, pop rock, indie rock, or geek rock. They are influenced by Kiss, Nirvana, Pixies, Cars, Cheap Trick, Pavement, Oasis, Beach Boys, among others. Similar artists, Beck, Ben Folds, Not a Surf, The Rentals, Ween, Superchunk, They Might Be Giants, Fountains of Wayne, Fall Out Boy, Joyce Manor, who I heard on that Everybody's in LA, John Mulaney thing, Charlie XCX, and others. Beverly Hills reached number 10 on the Hot 100, and Make Believe, that album, reached number 2 on the Billboard 200. Some fun facts. Did you guys know who produced this album? I didn't until doing the research.
I did, yes.
Yeah, was it Rick Ocasek?
Yep, Rick Ocasek.
No, it was Rick Ocasek.
I always say the wrong. I apologize.
Either way,
I've only made that mistake 50 times this podcast. Yep.
Yeah, you and everybody else. Yeah.
Their first show was closing for Keanu Reeves's band Dogstar in March of 1992.
Oh, wow. Dogstar. Nice. Good pull.
Is Keanu Reeves' Dogstar better or worse than Jared Leto 30 Seconds? Was it 30 Seconds to Mars? Is that his band, right?
That sounds right, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
Yeah, I think Dogstar's better, in my opinion. The name for the band came from a nickname Rivers' father gave him, which came from the character Weezer in the Our Gang Little Rascals short films.
they hold up very well. Yes. Hold up very well, I mean, probably could never be made again today.
Definitely not.
If you like all the things you can't do anymore, race related, like body image related, like all the things, right? Yeah. Like Little Rascals is impossible.
Good stuff. Matt Sharp was the de facto manager early on, and Rivers gave him and the band 1 year to get a record deal before Rivers accepted a scholarship at UC Berkeley. So that, I guess that worked out well. In November of 92, Weezer released a demo. It's November of 93. They released a demo called The Kitchen Tape, which included a version of the future single Say It Ain't So. The demo was heard by Todd Sullivan, an A&R man at Geffen Records, who signed Weezer in June of 93. It's November of 92. Sorry. And then June of 93. Ocasek convinced them to switch their guitar pickups from the neck to the bridge. I don't know what that means, not being a guitar player. It resulted in a brighter sound. And then Sharp and Cuomo imposed several rules on the band, including banning reverb and insisting on all downstrokes on the guitar. I didn't know that was a thing that you could do.
You're not doing any ups, you're just strumming down.
Yeah.
So people will strum down then strum back up, like to kind of like, you know,
but don't you get the same sound?
It's basically how I play rock band.
No, not technically, because you're starting when you strum down, you start with the lower notes and you go to the higher notes.
Oh,
and when you strum up,
okay,
you go from higher to lower. So you're actually moving your hand a lot faster because you got to keep the rhythm going. So it's a slight difference, but
got it. Oh, that's why I'm not a musician. Spike Jonze directed their videos for the singles "Undone," "Sweater Song," and "Buddy Holly," which became big hits on MTV. Some trivia for you guys: did this album cover strike you as similar to any previous album that we talked about's album cover?
Oh, I remember hearing who they were imitating.
Yep.
It wasn't like Parallel Lines, was it?
Nope. It was the Feelies' Crazy Rhythms, which we talked about way back in the 80s.
That's
also had a
great album.
But Weezer did not really have any prior knowledge of that. Rivers said he was inspired by a Beach Boys Greatest Hits cassette with the Beach Boys in front of in striped shirts in front of a blue background. And this album is quadruple platinum, which is still their best-selling album of all time. So not only the highest rated, as Matt pointed out in stats, but also their best selling. So, John, I thought of some questions to pose to you as part of your opening salvo. How do you hear Kiss in Weezer? And does Weezer transcend geek rock label that they get for you?
Wow. Okay, the first one's easier than the second one. First one's in the big power guitars they're playing, right? Like, you can definitely see... You know, he even references like, you know, like In My Garage and stuff like that playing. And you could absolutely see him grabbing like, you know, the first four Kiss albums, right? And like playing those riffs over and over again. So that's an easy one. And then later when you hear like an album like Maladroit, like you can definitely hear, you know, the hard rock guitars. Does it transcend geek rock? The first two albums do transcend geek rock. Then when they become sort of like a weird, eternal, you know, the famous story, isn't it, that like, and I don't want to steal too much from when we do Pinkerton, but like, I think it's like he pours it all out on that album, right? And basically everybody's like, this album sucks.
Yeah.
And like, he's like, feels rejected. And he's like, I'm never going to write a song that shows any of me again. And then you get like the Green album, which is like as sterile as it gets, but super catchy, right? Yeah. And I feel like that's the career they've done for forever. And like the geekiness in their music since album three to now is more like, we'll cover Toto and stuff. So it's like a geeky, like, it's like pop culture geeky, right? As opposed to themselves. Like, I actually found the first two albums to be... I connected a little bit more, even though I don't connect with geek culture at all, because... I thought they were like a smarter version of the self-loathing that sometimes comes with geek rock. And when I think of like geek rock, I think of like actively advertising like what is considered to be traditionally like dorky hobbies, right?
Yeah.
Mixed with like surprisingly big riffs because you secretly want to be popular and not geeky. That's part of the appeal. You know, the push-pull, right, of that whole genre. Like, it's the origin story for a lot. And, like, a constant obsession over, like, what girls think about you is, like, another thing. That's the only thing where I'm like, ugh, like, after a while, it's, you know. But less on this album. That's more of a Pinkerton thing for me. This album, I listen to this album like Matt listens to this album. It's just, it's about the riffs for me. And I like... It falls in that lane of there's just enough distortion that for like you guys, the basic bees of instruction that or of distortion that you guys are, this is the right amount of distortion, I think, for both of you guys. I could always use a little bit more, but I like the fact that there's a little bit of menace in the guitars with the distortion, and it definitely rocks out at times. But that's a long answer. But yes, Josh, I'd say this album transcends geek rock for me. What can you say? It's a lot of pieces that are very appealing coming together. There's a little bit of power pop in here. There's a little bit of like riff heavy, big like 70s arena rock. Like Weezer's always had like kind of like an arena rockness to them that I compare them a lot of times to, I know that Rivers Cuomo says that like the combination of like Nirvana and Kiss were like his main origin story, but there's a lot of like Cheap Trick in Weezer to me, and always has been, like playing it big, wearing your influences on your sleeve, and you know, kind of doing your best work when you play live. And you know, I saw Weezer in 1994. It was one of the earliest concerts I went to by myself.
Oh,
it was
wow.
It was at the Waterfront Stadium in Trenton when it was opening. They played right when the Sweater song had just come out on the radio and MTV. So, nice. And I remember them being pretty big because they combined a lot of things that were appealing into a package together that you didn't often hear. You rarely heard people with the melodies they had also play like big riff heavy rock, right, with a little bit of distortion in it as well. And when you did hear people like that, they kind of always looked like they were like kind of like dorky guys who looked like they were trying to be cool, but they were dorky in a different way, right? Like studio musician dorky, like, you know what I mean, as opposed to like you know glasses look like I'm reading the great books dorky. And I think there was a Gen X sensibility to their look that was sort of effortless, that worked for them. I think a lot of other bands later tried to like manufacture that, like that look, right? But I always felt like, you know, Weezer had a more like authentic lived in version of it, because yeah, they were a quirky group of guys, right?
Yep.
And yeah, like I've got more takes on this, but I don't want to steal all of your takes too, because I know both of you guys have, you know, relationships with this album. But I love the fact that you posed questions there, Josh. But yes, the Kiss influence is all over this, and yes, I would say this and later Pinkerton both transcend what I consider to be the worst of geek rock, because this is high end geek rock.
Yeah, nice. What about you, Matt? What do you think?
So first, quick story. My relationship with this record, I saw the Undone, the Sweater song video, and I was like transfixed on that. I love that video.
That does not surprise me at all.
I think they do that thing in that video where like it's in slow motion, but they are in time. The band's in time with the lyrics and the beats and stuff. So I think that they probably filmed them doing it at a faster rate and then slowed it down. So I always like it when they do that. They just kind of slow motion, but it's in real motion at the same time. So
yeah, they do that thing. I watched it today. They do like things that don't make sense to how the song sounds like in context.
Yeah.
Like Rivers takes his hand off the guitar at one point and it's still like playing and things like that.
There's that too. Yeah, for sure. So I always thought this was interesting because that's an interesting song for them just period, because it's discordant, right? It's like their first single does not sound like pretty much anything else on this record or anything else that Weezer really, I mean, you know, to kind of have this off key looping guitar sound over and over again is kind of unique. So it's kind of, I always thought that was interesting that was the, you know, the lead single. But I liked that enough. But this was also the time when I was going through a period where I was like buying records based on a single, and I was like let down by what was on the record. I was like, yeah, that sucks. Like, you know, it's okay, right? It's not what the single is. So I bought the single because I didn't want to like be let down again. And the B side of the single was Holiday. I was like, now that's a really good song too. So I was like, all right. So I got into that for a while. And I think eventually I heard enough that good things about the record that I was like, okay, let me get the album. And then I was just like from the get-go, like the first three. And I think by that time, Buddy Holly was also out. So I was like, okay, I really like that second single. And then the first three tracks off it, I was like, okay. And like, and it just sank right in, you know? So I know this album very well. This is an album that a lot of my friends know very well. And it's like, it's bonded me with other people that I've met at parties and stuff like, you know, just really into this record. And listening to it this week, I'm just thinking to myself, I'm like, this is a perfect record. Like there is nothing at all wrong with this album. This is perfect, note perfect from the get-go. There's not a bad note on this. This just flows so nicely. It's catchy as all get out. The amount of distortion, the way that they're playing, the production behind it, the way that it builds to the choruses, the harmonies are great. You know, like there's just this crescendo after crescendo of great ending to the album and great chorus and great and harmonies. And then they end with a song like Only in Dreams, which is kind of like this, the ultimate like kind of build song, right? The starting off just from barely anything to this huge sound at the end, and then it fades out slowly again. So it's just, it's, yes, the singles are great, but also are all the quote unquote deep cuts. It's an album that I fell in love with once I listened to it, like, kind of automatically, and I never get sick of this record. I've heard this time and time again, and it just, there's nothing that bad that I can say about it, right? This is like a, this to me is a perfect elite album. This will easily make my top 20 at the end of the decade. I am confident of that. I have a smile on my face the whole time I listen to this record. And, you know, there's plenty of bad things you can say about Weezer as a whole, right? As, you know, yeah, particularly after the first two, maybe first three records, there's a lot of like, there's a reason this is at the top. They kind of hit their stride with their first two records in particular. And then there's some great singles that are peppered throughout their career, but kind of like stuff that makes you go, yeah, it's not. They never really recaptured their sound the way that they captured their sound in this record. So, yeah, I love this record. It's just, it's perfect for me. Big thumbs up.
Wow. I thought I would be the most positive, but Matt really trumped me. I think this is a great album. This is a kind of a gateway album for me. I know every word to the lyrics on this. I like know the music cues. I know like when the guitars come in and out. I've heard this album many times. I do love this album. But I was trying to come to it this time with like new perspective. And I guess the thing I noticed was that I think John mentioned this, kind of the like subtly heavy guitar sound with like the mm-hmm. pop kind of melodies. And that's kind of like where their sweet spot is, I think. And I didn't really appreciate that or kind of notice that, I think, until recently. I like Pinkerton more than this album. I think that's the elite album for me. I came way past the time when there was that backlash that John mentioned. Like I never got that or, you know, picked up on that or even agreed with that. I thought that
it was a real thing. I remember it real time.
Sure was. Yep.
Yeah. I think that anyway, when we can talk about that when we get to Pinkerton, but, there are no bad songs on this album, in my opinion, as well. I just like the, again, this is like, this album also has a retro feel to it, not in the same way that Portishead does, but I do see the like the Beach Boys kind of influence, you know, especially on a song like Buddy Holly or something like that. And that video is still holds up really well, too. I watched that today as well. It was a very clever, and it does seem kind of seamless still in the effects.
It seems like a video that maybe Veruca Salt would have done, knowing more about them now. Yeah.
Yeah. But My Name is Jonas is just like kind of a great starting song to their energy and vibe. And I think the geekiness was like an appeal to me, but I didn't ever really pick up on that until
Their lyrics are nonsense. That's my one knock on Weezer at times. It's like, what even is this? You know, for guys as smart as they are, it's like, what are they singing about? You know?
Yeah, that's true. But maybe that gets to your point too. I think maybe the lyrics are more dialed in on Pinkerton as well. In terms of being more self-referential.
Confessional was always, confessional. I think, like,
Yeah. But yeah, I guess, what am I trying to say? Yeah, I unabashedly like this album as well. I don't really have quibbles with it. The singles, the album is so consistent that I can't even really pick out the singles anymore. There are other songs that I like just as much as the singles, I guess I should say. So that's a positive thing in my mind. And yeah, it's great. I'd be interested. They definitely evolve, and I definitely fell off on them at some point and got sick of kind of their gimmick or whatever they kind of evolved into.
Some might say devolve would be a term. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. And then when I saw some of the stuff that came out, like their covers albums and things like that, I really kind of like really developed a bad taste in my mouth. But I saw them live last year here, and they were great and just as fun to sing along to, and they played all the hits. And
so I think what's funny to me is I've always processed Weezer as like what they are now.
Yeah,
like just that at the beginning their music was stronger, right, but like to me they were always that band. But I know that lots of people connected with them viscerally as like avatars for who they were in like the rock world. And I think those are the people that really took it hard when like Rivers Cuomo's like, I'm over that period and I'm going to spend the next 25 years basically like, you know, going through that. And I also always kind of like got the feeling from Rivers Cuomo that like we live in an era now where like nerd culture is sort of like, I'm going to really be happy that I'm in nerd culture. And actually nerd culture is cool culture, right? We're going to take it. Yeah. I always got the feeling like Rivers Cuomo's like, I'm a fucking nerd, but I don't want to be a nerd. Like I want to like cool stuff. You know what I mean? And like an old school version of like nerds, right? Yeah. Like because nerds used to like aspire to get in a rock band to be cool, not like make being a nerd in a rock band cool, right? They like, they wanted it to become cooler, right? And I always feel like Rivers Cuomo was one of the last people that was
like he had a chip on his shoulder.
Yeah, like I mean, he didn't necessarily do it cool, but like the bands he liked and his influences and like the pop culture he wanted to like consume, right, were much more mainstream and traditionally cool things, right? And so I kind of always saw him as that, and so I do think it's funny that people like listen to Pinkerton like 7,000 times. We're like, oh my god, I also. I'm attracted to half Japanese girls and like think if, you know, do women find me attractive enough and try to play my guitar. And then he's like, all right, I'm over that. Like, in fact, I kind of wish I didn't do that because I'm embarrassed. And there's other people like, no, you need to go back to doing that. And he's like, no, that's like not at all what I want to be known as. It's like embarrassing. And now I'm just going to write songs that make me more popular. So I always found that to be funny because like I came into Weezer, they were like not an avatar for me. So they were just like a pop, a power pop band that also, you know, really could plug in their guitars and bang it out, which I appreciate, but that's what they were to me. Yep. So,
they've become a multi-generational band at this point too, in terms of parents who were into them now have their kids who are into them, and like that's like the crossover appeal is like massive now for
them. And nerd culture became mainstream, so people like process Weezer as a rock band instead of like a, you know, like I said, they're kind of like Cheap Trick, and when you look at Cheap Trick in the late 70s, people are like, oh yeah, they write good songs, but yeah, come on, I mean Cheap Trick isn't cool, you know what I mean? There's like nothing good. But then like the culture has evolved, right, where now you know you have to talk about how you aren't cool, right? Like even if you're like gorgeous and like cool, you have to like pretend you're not, and you secretly are like nerdy, right? It's like going on the way. So it makes sense that they would be the rock band
it's funny we cover this right after we just did Green Day, because John, you were talking about when you were at Green Day there was like different crowds, like there's the Dookie crowd versus the American Idiot crowd, and I saw Weezer play, I remember I saw them play in at Lollapalooza in Chicago in 2005. And they did play a lot of Blue Album. They played some Pinkerton, and there was it was a younger crowd, and there were people that were not feeling that as much as they were like We Are All on Drugs in Beverly Hills, which was kind of like where it started to lose me. And I was just like, you guys are getting amped for the wrong songs. You know, I found myself being a little bit like old
you got
man,
triggered?
Like yells at cloud a little bit, just not terrible, because I'm okay with those songs, but.
They're supposed to be kind of geeky like me. They're not supposed to write songs about wanting to live in Beverly Hills.
It wasn't even about it's you know me. It's not about the lyrics. It's about the quality of the song, right? Like OC.
But, this is a travesty for me. You're not allowed to like the OC. You should be watching Deep Space Nine or whatever the hell it is that like you know and playing Final Fantasy.
I never did that, but. Yeah, no, but it was interesting how like the younger crowd were way more into the, you know, like because that's right when Make Believe, I think that's the album that those songs are from. Mm-hmm. And that's the album that I think that had come out recently and people going nuts for that. And I was just like, man, that's not what's getting me amped right now. So it was kind of interesting. But yeah, they're still putting stuff out, man. They're still touring, and I've seen plenty of shows since then, and people love them some Weezer. It is a cross-generational band for sure.
Yep.
And then it comes full circle, Matt, because you are getting in your old man feelings. And then a week later, you could go see Green Day when you're like, play the American Idiot songs.
Do you like American Idiot? I like American Idiot and Dookie.
So it all comes full circle.
Yeah. Yep. As if American Idiot is new Green Day.
Right. Yeah, you're around long enough.
Damn, that album's 20 years old.
It's like Benjamin Button. We all go from young to middle age to old, and the old is the same thing as the, you know, the young of us. So we devolve into it. So And what a great way to end, great. Just like this episode.
It just evolved.